Well, good evening. We'll go ahead and get started this evening. Renee, please show all board members present except for Ms. Gilkey. And if you'll join me for the Pledge of Allegiance. First item on the agenda is the approval of the agenda. Do we have any changes tonight? All right, do I have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Perkins.
Second.
Oh, did you want to?
Yes, I'm sorry.
All right.
I was taking care of anniversary flowers here.
Gotcha. Okay.
On the consent agenda, I'd like to pull number 6, the personnel other 2.
With your motion again?
So moved with that correction.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Ms. Kraft. Any questions, comments? All in favor? B60, thank you. Next item is public comments on agenda items. Dr. Mellon, I don't think we...
None tonight,
none
sir.
None tonight, thank you. All right, next item is board planning. Facilities update.
Yes, board. What I'd like to do to start off with is, again, a couple weeks ago, if you remember, I was able to present a recommendation to you that would involve building 3 brand new buildings and renovating 4 buildings. It would also involve closing 4 buildings and also repurposing a 5th building. So let's just go over that just for a minute, if you don't mind. Why are we doing this? We're doing this because we have a problem. The problem is really at least twofold. Number one, we have a conditions issue with some of our buildings. We've had a comprehensive facility study done, as you know. Jamie Lake from Covert Hawkins is here again, just in case you have questions. But the conditions of several of our buildings are in such a position from an infrastructure perspective that we need to do something to address those issues. We also have an enrollment forecast that calls for an increase in enrollment because of the growth in our area over the next 5 to 10 years. Maybe conservatively 900 to 1,000 more students coming into our district over the next 5 to 10 year period, and that's a conservative number. So you have conditions of buildings, you have enrollment issues, and currently we also have issues in our district where we have some concerns related to safety. You look at River Valley Middle School, Charlestown Middle School, open concept, North Haven Elementary, open concept buildings, no walls, no doors. We need to enclose those buildings to make them safer. It's also not a good learning environment for kids in those buildings because there are distractions. You can hear what's going on in other rooms. I've been in those buildings, I've experienced it myself, and we need to do something about that. So that's really a top priority. In Charlestown, we have the growth issues. You have a Pleasant Ridge and Jonathan Jennings. Both buildings are in need of major renovation or repair. So the recommendation is that we build a brand new building off of 403 between Salem Noble and Bethany. And we close the current Pleasant Ridge. And why would we do that? Because we can't expand Pleasant Ridge on its current location. It only has 8 acres. We can't grow that building out. It's landlocked. So we close that building. What's another reason why we need it? Well, Charlestown High School will be projected to grow over time. Currently, if we grow Charlestown High School, from Charlestown High School to the football field is where the growth would have to occur. That's the design. If you expand that building, it would occur between the building and the football stadium. What's there? A football practice area that really is not of high quality to begin with. And we have tennis courts that spend time being underwater because of where they're positioned. So we need to have a place to allow for expansion of the Charlestown High School building eventually, and then move athletic facilities over to that Pleasant Ridge site. If you come down into Jeffersonville, the 3 buildings that are in the worst shape are Maple, Spring Hill, and TJ. We love all those buildings. We love the kids in all those buildings. We care a great deal about them. It's not about them. It's about the buildings they're in. We have a problem with a lack of equity in our facilities. It's not fair that we have students in those buildings who attend those schools every day, overcoming the mechanical elements of those buildings, when we have other students who are fortunate enough to go to a Riverside, a Utica, a New Washington Elementary. Those three buildings are in excellent shape. We need to have equity in our facilities. So what we would do is we would close Maple. We'd move the student population to Parkview Middle School. We'd renovate Parkview Middle School. It's on 12 acres of land, not big enough for a middle school, truly. It's landlocked. We would bring the Bridgepoint population also down to Parkview. The combination would be roughly around 610, 620, which is still a manageable size. Bridgepoint Elementary, the building would stay open. We would repurpose it. We've got a tremendous program, as you know, at Cordon Porter, Clark County Middle High, but one of the problems we have is not enough space for those kids. We need to be able to have more space to expand those programs because they're two of the best programs in the state of Indiana. So that's what we do at Bridgepoint. You would then, coming up to the east side of 10th Street, you have Parkview that would become an elementary. We can name it Parkview. You could name it whatever. We could get those two buildings to work on that. That's fine. But along with Riverside and also Utica, they would feed into a new middle school. Now, we started to look at where would that new middle school be. We want it east of 10th Street. So it's clear. Right now, we have students at Utica, Wilson, in North Haven. Some fifth graders go to River Valley, and some go to Parkview. We want it very clear that if you go to those elementaries, you will end up going to the new Jefferson Middle School. There's land up around this area. We'd probably need about 30 acres. We would secure that. We'd build a brand new middle school. Remember, all of our growth is projected to come in northern Jeffersonville up through Charlestown. So this middle school would be strategically placed to accommodate that. On the other side of 10th Street, Spring Hill, a building 1967, a lot of issues. Three split section classrooms. What are those? That's a teacher that's teaching at least two grade levels. We have three of those. That's unfair to those students at Spring Hill. We cannot have that. That's not what's educationally sound. We move the population up to North Haven. We renovate North Haven. There's land to do it. We can make that happen. So we merge those populations. TJ, closed, landlocked, can't expand. There's nothing else we can do with that building on that site. So we move the population. We build a brand new elementary on the Wilson Elementary site. Brand new. The Wilson population currently would go into this building, and the majority of the TJ population would go there as well. We may need to look at the population there, depending upon how we might have to redistrict. We may have to send some of the TJ population to the new North Haven. Again, those buildings can have their own names. River Valley would be renovated. So now you have North Haven, Parkwood, and a new building on the Wilson property all feeding into the River Valley. Three elementaries to the east, three elementaries to the west, all feeding middle schools, one on the east, one on the west. So this is a 20-month process of study. It's a $119 million proposal. And what I'd like to also share with you tonight is $119 million sounds like a lot of money, and it is. But our kids are worth it. And we need to make an investment in our community. Our kids are our most important asset. The future of our community is going to be dependent upon our students, and they deserve the best facilities we can provide for them. You know, a lot of school districts, when they do their planning for buildings, they develop a long-term plan, and over time, they're able to modify or upgrade their buildings. That didn't happen in Greater Clark. All of our buildings are all at a point where they all need work. The high schools 5 years ago, they all needed major work. $100 million was poured into those three high schools at the time, and still we have half of Jeff High that was never touched. And so we've got to start putting money into these buildings, or else we're going to put ourselves really behind the eight ball. So what's the cost factor to the individual taxpayer? Well, this just gives you a sense of what would happen with our debt service over a period of time. The key factor that you would see in 2016 is there would be roughly a 13, almost 14 cent increase in the tax rate. What I think is important to note here Now, this is based upon schools, the impact, the tax impact related to a person's tax bill. This is the school aspect of it. So the 13 cents, let's talk about that for a minute. In 2014, our overall tax rate was $1.06. The assessed valuation of this Greater Clark County Schools, our property values, increased by $60 million in 2015. It's the first time the assessed valuation went up, I believe, in 5 years. What that did is that dropped the tax rate to 93 cents. So that can be viewed for the individual taxpayer as a good thing. This building project would put the same tax rate, would take us right back up to about that $1.06. It'd be about the same level in 2016 as it was in 2014. I think that's good news. I think that's exciting. I know we're talking about a lot of money, but that rate is pretty exciting. Now let's go to an individual taxpayer. All right. The median priced home in Greater Clark, looking at all the homes in the Greater Clark County Schools, the median value, of course, that means that there are just as many homes valued above 124.5 as there are below, right in the middle. That's the median average, is 124.5. So if I own that home, my tax bill would be $66.88 greater in 2016 than compared to 2015. That can be broken down by $557 per month is the cost to the taxpayer of that homeowner. If I own a $200,000 home, you can see it's an additional $134 for the year, which is broken down to $11.19 a month. So I think that it's really vital that our community understands that we're trying to be very sensitive to our taxpayers. But there has to be a balance. If you want to make sure that you are securing the future of our students, you have quality buildings. These aren't Taj Mahals. These are quality buildings that can last for another 50 years. Then it's going to cost something. It's an investment, though. I can't think of a better way to invest your money than in our kids. So if I'm that median-priced homeowner, it's going to cost me $5.57 more per week. $67 less than for the year. And I think that's pretty significant. I think that's exciting. I think that that's more reasonable than some people may have thought it would be. We have a lot of education to do, but I'm prepared to do the work. And I'm prepared to go out, as you know, Board, with your authorization and as your representative to do the work necessary to make sure if we have to go door to door, speak to every group, that we'll go ahead and we'll break this down for eventually we'll have a calculator for each and every homeowner. They can go in, they can figure out, here's the AV of my household, what will that do to my tax bill? And remember, a tax bill is made up of taxes that come from many different entities. A large portion of that tax bill is going to our school system. So I think it's important to note that whatever I would be paying on my tax bill for 2015, if I'm that median price homeowner, and if nothing else changes other than this building project, I can expect to pay $67 more in 2016 than I did in 2015. So I think that that's good news moving forward. What about time frame? Board, as you know, I've been out, Renee's been great. She's been scheduling me. I've been talking to staffs. I've been talking to parent groups. I'm going to continue to do that. I'll be talking to other community groups over the course of the next month. We'll begin surveying the community to get their thoughts and their input and feedback. This is all about information gathering. It would be my hope that through gathering all that information that we might be able to bring to you by mid-June a recommendation to move forward. It'd be in the form of what's called a 1028 hearing, open to the public, where we would finalize our recommendation to you. Right now, it's simply my recommendation, but we've been soliciting input and feedback, and we need to, if it needs to be modified and improvised in some way, then we'll do whatever it takes. but that would be the goal. I don't know if you have questions or comments. I know you've had a little bit of time to process through, but is there anything in particular that I can be addressing for you at this point?
Well, I just jotted something down. As it stands right now, can every elementary student in Greater Clark take all the related art classes, music, band, PE, and all that on a daily basis, or as they can't, right?
Right now, there are concerns with some of our smaller elementaries. We try to provide a level of music, art, and PE to all students, but how that's being delivered is different at each and every elementary. By having buildings that are slightly larger than we currently have them, we will be able to have a more comprehensive art, music, and PE program in every elementary, in addition to preschools, English language learner programs, emotionally disabled student programs, and severe and profound programs. Right now, we have a lot of students in those ELL and special ed areas we have to bus to other schools. So even though they may live in one community, in one specific community, they have to be bused to another school. That's not right. That's not fair. That's not equitable. We need to change that. So it's a good question that you're asking, because we're making sure that we have comprehensive elementary programs in every school. We're cognizant of size. Remember, the average size of an elementary in Indiana is 580 students. Our largest elementary is Parkwood at 570. So even our largest elementary is slightly less than the average size in Indiana. So our community is used to a certain size of elementary. But when we build these schools, the goal is to build them in such a way that you basically have a primary, which is your pre-K through grade 2, and an intermediate wing in the building. That's 3 through 5. And at an elementary level, I know I have 3 children. At the elementary level, what's that key relationship? It's between the teacher and the students in their classroom. Whether I'm, if we have a 25-to-1 student-to-teacher ratio in our elementaries, whether I'm in a 370-student elementary or I'm in a 570-student elementary, I still, as a teacher, I have 25 students. And that relationship between those students and the teacher is the key. So I think people, I can understand their sensitivity to size, but we think we've found the right balance. These elementaries are not so large that kids will get lost in the shuffle, but they're large enough in order to make sure that we have a comprehensive level of programming in each one and still have a personal touch and relationship between teachers and staff and students.
Thank you.
Dr. Millen, just one question. Can you walk us through what redistricting might look like? I mean, obviously, that's going to be part of this program or this project. So can you sort of walk us through how that would happen?
Sure. You know, one of the things that would happen, because, you know, we're merging in some cases, like in the Maple and Bridgepoint circumstance, you're merging those two schools into one. But what you would have to do is you'd have to really talk about what does that district look like, because we want to make sure we keep manageable school sizes. So we have to look at that. Riverside could accommodate some more students. Utica can accommodate some more students. So if we have to look and make sure that our sizes are manageable and reasonable, then what we'd be doing is moving our district slightly around to make sure that the school sizes stayed manageable. That would be true on the other side of 10th Street as well, is that we would have to look at moving populations to the north. And frankly, we have to start looking at, in northern Jeffersonville, we have a whole population that lives north of Jeffersonville, south of Charlestown, and some of those individuals come to Utica and really probably should be going up into Charlestown. We have to look at our district boundaries. We may have to move our boundary so that more students in certain locations north of Jeffersonville would be going up into Charlestown. And we have to talk about our new Washington families. You know, we have to look at the Charlestown district, and we have to see north of Charlestown does that district have to be slightly modified in order to get more students up into New Washington? So this plan, in my opinion, will positively impact every student in Greater Clark. And so if that helps with the redistricting, we're going to have to look and manage where kids are moving, because we want to be respectful of their neighborhoods. If their neighborhood was this big, now their neighborhood may be this big. But we the one thing that we want to be careful of is that they still feel the sense of neighborhood. That's going to be important. And I think we can make that happen with some minor adjustments in terms of how we would redistrict. Not major adjustments, but minor.
Okay, so follow-up question on that is, would you anticipate that being all laid out prior to this going to referendum? Or would this be something that you would have to think about after, you know, the referendum is approved?
I probably could start to do some preliminary planning in that regard. And I'd be happy to do that, Board, if that's what you'd like me to do. I think it's important, though, that, you know, we make sure that, I think it's very vital. It's sort of like the numbers, the financial numbers we put up there. Yeah. People in our community expect those to be rock solid, accurate. That's why we didn't bring them out to you until tonight. We have a financial team of experts. They've evaluated and reviewed it, and those numbers are solid. I want to make sure I don't want to present some numbers to you too prematurely in terms of redistricting, and then people hold us to it later. So I just want to be careful with that, Board, moving forward.
So it would be sort of a best guess prior to that. I mean, because I can anticipate we will probably get those type questions.
Yes.
As we begin to locate these new schools. Okay, where am I going to go?
Right.
So, okay.
Be happy to put something together.
Did you say we were going to try to have preschool in every building?
Right. In fact, next year, we are going to have a preschool in every building, but we've had to move some things around in order to find the room to make that happen. We had 7 preschools in our 12 elementaries this year. We had 7 of those elementaries that had a preschool. Next year, we found some grant funding to bring a preschool into the other 5. But the problem we're having is we have some buildings that are already at capacity where we're going to have to modify. For example, let me tell you another thing that happens, and Board, I may be telling you more than you want to know, but I hope this is helpful. You know, in some of our buildings, you have what's called music or art on a cart. There's not a set music room that kids go to or an art room that kids go to. So what happens is that the art teacher or music teacher have a cart, and they have to cart the cart down to a specific classroom. So they have to actually provide that instruction in a regular classroom. Well, that is possible. Our teachers are highly capable and cope and adapt easily, and so do our kids. But in a more comprehensive elementary, there's a designated room that's that teacher's home that can be set up, whether it's for art or it's music. Just like a gymnasium is set up for a PE teacher, you have to have a special place for art and music. That's not happening currently the way we have things set up. So I believe that if you look at art, music, and PE, those are also very important to all of our students in our school system. They also deserve to have that kind of high level of quality and proper facility equitably across all of our schools. That may have been more than you wanted to know, but I will tell you that the great fortune I've had is to be in every one of our buildings multiple times a year. I see what's happening. I see our people overcoming our facilities. Keep in mind, our maintenance people and custodians are doing a great job, but when things start to break down, it becomes tougher and tougher to keep them up to speed, and that's where we are in several of our buildings in our district. We need to take action, and we need to take action fairly quickly.
Did I understand you to say, and I know that the impact on the tax rate is going to be one of the big issues, so I want to make sure I understand this. We will have a calculator on our website eventually where a person will be able to take their tax bill, look at the assessed valuation, which is not necessarily what I would sell my house for.
Right.
But you put that in, and it would actually give us an estimated tax increase.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll make.
I think that will be very helpful.
Well, and I think that as we move forward on this, Board, I mean, the financial component of this, I've always believed in balance. Everything in life, there should be a balance. So what are we talking about here? We're talking about the education of our kids and the cost to provide the kind of quality education that we believe our community deserve, you know, our community believes those kids deserve. Okay, so what does that mean? We have to find the right balance. There's no such thing as a free lunch. We have to be willing to pay and invest in order to make this happen. So we have to find that correct tipping point. What is the right number? Obviously, all of us would prefer just to have brand new renovated or brand new facilities and not have to pay for them. Well, that's not a realistic endeavor. If you want something in this life, you are going to have to pay for it. But I think it's important that I know you believe this, and I believe it, that I know our taxpayers in this area, I know our citizens, and I know we've got to be sensitive to the cost. So we've got to find the right, and I think that we have found something that is a reasonable project in terms of its overall cost and its impact on our citizens.
I don't know if I should admit this out loud. I calculated mine, and I spend that much at Starbucks every year.
Well, that's, you know, when you break it down to a weekly cost, yep, and you just think about what we spend money on, I just think we need to be respectful of all of our citizens and the diversity that we have in terms of our socioeconomic status in our community. We have a lot of citizens that have already, you know, has sent their children through schools, maybe have grandchildren in schools. I mean, we need to be very considerate of all of our citizens. But I think that all of our citizens who have chosen to live in Greater Clark, they all would want to have the best quality of community that they can have. And I'll say it again, they're gonna finish this East End Bridge, which is an unbelievable thing. We have businesses moving into River Ridge and in other parts of our school system. That's awesome. But if we're not careful, as the people come, if we don't have the homes, the quality of life issues, the schools, then they will look to live elsewhere. And that bridge will become a convenient way for them to live elsewhere and to work here. Just like 265 will make it convenient for people to live elsewhere and work here. Do we want to be the school system where people work and don't choose to live? I didn't come here as a superintendent of Greater Clark County Schools and bring my three children with that in mind. And I'm going to bet that we have a lot of people in our community that will buy into that same thing. This is not unreasonable. This is needed. Whether you pay now, we can pay now, or we can pay a heck of a lot more later, because at some point, these buildings need to be replaced. They're at that point. So let's get out ahead of it, be proactive, and not have to be reactive. That's what I hope that people will buy into.
Further questions for Dr. Mellon? Well, Dr. Mellon, thank you for the summary. I mean, I think you've got a responsibility to paint as accurate a picture of our buildings as we can. I think it's our responsibility to balance that with what the tax impact's going to be, and I think we've gotten some really good information now to take that back and begin to think through that. So, you know, compliments to you, compliments to Mr. Lake for the work he's done, and I just appreciate it. So
you're welcome.
I know it's been a lot to it, and your work's just beginning. So,
thank you. I know that.
All right. Okay, we'll move on to the next item, which is policy review, NEOLA 6,000, 7,000, 8,000, and 9,000 series. Ms. Lewis, going to take us through that?
Yes, thank you, and good evening. We have loaded into our Google Docs for your review the 6,000 series, which is on finance, 7,000 on property, 8,000 on operations, and 9,000 on relations. Those are the final four series for you to have the chance to review. We're excited about getting them all in there. We are still making some changes because we're still internally in the review process also. The goal next month is to take this group to the final reading, the first meeting of the month, and then the second meeting of the month will be handling any reviews or questions about any of the policies. The ones that you send to us that have questions or suggestions, Pam Maples, my executive assistant, is making copies of those. We have a folder to review with Dr. Mellon, and then we'll have answers for you. So we're on target. We're moving right along. I have to say publicly thank you so much to Pam Maples. She has done an outstanding job getting everything loaded and taking comments and inputting the different changes that not only I have made on an initial review, but also our cabinet level, and then you all as board members. So she's just done a marvelous job. I couldn't have done it without her. But we're almost to the step of approval.
Yay.
We're getting there.
Thank you.
Any
thank
questions?
You, Ms. Lewis.
Don't think so.
Stimulating. Next is the student clinic update. Dr. Hare got it right this time. So.
Mr. Pavey, board. Just a brief update. You can see we're up a little bit this past month compared to the previous month. But having said that, we're down just a little bit at Jeffersonville High School. So it's kind of going back and forth, but overall we are up. We can continue to see the number of students who have primary care physicians increasing, and we gave about 35% of the students that we saw prescriptions, and that is an increase. So certainly an increase in the number of medicines that have been sent home with the students, and just a reminder that that is free of charge. I think it's kind of cool. We have seen 494 students, so we're approaching the 500 mark. Actually, we went over, but I'll save that officially for next month. So we've seen over 500 students in those clinics since we started in October. We've been working. I met with the health aides in our elementary schools and see what could we do to increase the participation in the elementary schools. And one of the major suggestions that they said is, you know, we don't take those attendance calls. When a parent calls in and says, my son or daughter is sick, we don't get to talk to them. So part of it was we are going back and educating we're educating our folks that are taking those attendance calls to let parents know when they call in and say their son or daughter is sick, to remind them we have a clinic. So we brainstormed with them and had some excellent ideas, and we'll put those into play for next year as well. And you know, really had a big jump in our K-8. Last year, the K-8, we saw 24 students, and this past month it jumped to 45. So we're starting to see a little bit of that increase, but then we dropped off a little bit at our high school. So still trying to kind of figure out the ins and outs of this, but still have seen, again, over 500 students. A lot of them receiving free care and a lot of positive comments. So just continue to working to increase the participation.
Okay. I know there are a lot of factors that go into student attendance, but are there any conclusions, or do we see any attendance positives out of this? I know you could kind of consider it. I mean, the fact that we're sending a lot of students back to class after they're checked out and going back to class, in the past we may have sent that student home.
That's right, or it would have taken them longer to recover and missed more days.
Right.
So certainly we've not seen a decrease in our attendance rate. You're right, it would be hard.
There's a lot of factors.
There are a lot of factors and the correlation on that. But I'll tell you, that could be something I can look at and see if we can bring you something back kind of as a year-end result.
Because we thought that would be the impact that we would see as some students.
So still exciting. It's just trying to figure out. We get one propped up, and then one goes down. So it's just.
I've heard really positive things about.
It's very positive, and both of the nurse practitioners are extremely
yes.
Doing a great job. So, thank you.
Great update. Thank you. Next is fund monitoring report, Dr. Deichel.
Okay. As soon as Renee gets it loaded up there. The good news is we're paying bills, we have money, we're making payroll. You can see we're projecting right here our cash balance to drop to 1.7 million, almost 1.8 million, and that was because of the retroactive raise that we gave all of our employees. So that's the good news. Nothing really exciting in the general fund, if you want to skip to debt service. In debt service, we were able to actually get approval from the state to spread out our tax cap loss over debt service, pension debt, capital projects, bus replacement, and bus operating. So we finally got that approval. You had signed the resolution, you know, asking the state to do that for us. So if you look here, let's see, can you go down a little bit in the debt service? Oh, back up. Okay, right here, we're showing $1 million being taken out of debt service. If we didn't have that resolution, that $1 million would have been hitting capital projects. Probably 60% of that $1 million would have gone to CPF. So we would have lost a lot of money in CPF. Another $350,000 would have been lost in transportation operating, and then the balance would have been in transportation bus replacement. So you can see how it's really helped us, so we're not losing the money in the other funds. This is just the cash balance that we have because we're able to go for 18 months in debt service and pension debt. Okay, go to pension. In pension, you can see we lost $159,000, so we're still okay with a positive $326,000. In capital projects, instead of us losing, you know, over $1.5 million or $1.6 million, we're only losing $888,000 for the tax caps. We're trying to be real careful on how we spend the money, so we're looking at about a $300,000 cash balance by the end of the year. Depends on what new things pop up that I'm not aware of, and they seem like they're popping up a lot. Transportation operating, we're going to lose $617,000 in tax caps there, and this is my fund that I'm watching. We're going to be in positive, we're going to be in a negative $112,000 potentially. So we've got to look at doing some major cost cutting, rearranging some expenditures, see if we can get back to zero. I'll be happy with zero. And then in bus replacement fund, we're losing $166,000. That could have been, a bus and a half of a lift bus with air conditioning for special ed. Could have been about 378 passenger buses, but we're losing $166,000. So we should end the year with around $36,000-$37,000. So, and then in the rainy day fund, really didn't have any activity there. We're still sitting with $3.5 million. So, any questions? We're doing good. We're out of the red. We're back in the black, except for one fund.
No, Dr. Dyko, I just want to give you compliments on your improvement made in the last several months on using that laser. It is outstanding. Great job.
It's me remembering it. It's in my desk.
Yeah, appreciate you not bouncing it off my head like you were. So. Are there questions for Dr. Dyko?
You know, right. Board, just one thing. Dr. Dyko does a great job with this, but I think that possible circuit breaker loss that's marked in every one of those funds is something that we just have to keep in mind, because I just totaled it roughly about $2.8 million. $2.8 million less that we have to invest in our facilities, and that happens on an annual basis. So if you think about that, that is something that we'll have to continue to think about as we're out in the community, because that happens on an annual basis, which is great for our individual taxpayers, but it's a big loss not only to us as a governmental agency, but to other governmental agencies as well. And that then there forces also the other conversation about what do you do when you do need to put money into facilities. So I just wanted to bring that out.
Well, just in 5 years since the tax cap have been in existence, Greater Clark has lost over $11 million. The county itself has lost, in all taxing units, including us, we've lost $51 million in 5 years. So that's how tax caps are affecting us.
No comment.
Me too. I get in trouble.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Dyko.
Thank you.
Next, we have student achievement, middle school academic requirements. Ms. Schellenberg.
Hi, thank you. Appreciate the opportunity to share some structural changes we'd like to look at for 15-16. also appreciate the presence of the middle school leadership, administrators, and future middle school students in the audience. It's been a great year for me professionally and working with the middle schools, and the structural changes we want to talk about come at no cost. It's really just kind of organizing and aligning the work, our work, with other work that's going on in the district. Just historically, wanted to give you, in 2005, we came before the Board of School Trustees, and they authorized a middle school promotion and progression guideline, which was also considered, or called exit outcomes at the time. And that document was generated as a result of articulation that took place between middle school and high school teachers, where high school teachers felt like they were receiving students who had, for lack of a better word, skated through middle school, maybe had been promoted because of age, but had not passed, you know, a regulated amount of core content. And so as we went to address this issue, we set up the exit outcomes where students had to pass their core content, and if they did not, then they were moved into a support system, and those academic supports would be after school. They would go after school and or summer school. And so that stayed in effect for about 3 or 4 years, and then as administration changed and changes were going in the district, we utilized more intervention blocks within the day, and we're not using the after school external. If you look at our data, one of the biggest concerns for us is right now, when we look at our data dashboard, we look at the number of students who had one or more failing grade during a school year. Mm-hmm. So that's our that's kind of our temperature, how we check how our kids are doing. Last year, 15% of our middle school students had at least one or more. As of third quarter, that data is hanging right there between 13-15%. Our corporation goal is for that number to get down to 5%. And we know that a lot of what it takes are student ownership of their work, communication between school and home. So we're hoping that our recommendations through this guidance will help address some of these issues. What we're looking at for next year are recommendations that we feel like are aligned to college and career readiness. We feel like it's a good time to move forward, not only because of the work ethic and the college and career that we're working on as a district, but in this new time, we're heading back towards a graduation qualifying exam. The assessment series in the state is changing. The academic standards have been renamed college and career readiness standards. So we feel like this is a natural time to make this adjustment. And what we'd like to do basically is to implement a credit system in the middle school very similar to that of what at the high school. So kids are prepared when they get into middle school, they know how many credits it takes to move from one grade level to another. We think that we've done better work with students, especially with having the access to the Chromebooks. They check their PowerSchool grades on a weekly basis. That's part of their impact program. But we think sometimes when you're just dealing with course titles and you don't align that to some numbers, kids sometimes get lost in just, we think this will organize their work and their understanding a little bit more. What we did was we looked at how high school set up. If you think about a general diploma track or a Core 40, which the Core 40 diploma track is really the college and career readiness track. So what we did was we looked at how our days are structured, how our schedules are structured, and we said for students to complete or to progress to ninth grade, they need 24 credits in the core content. So that would be basically 2 credits a year, one per semester, very similar to what we do at the high school. We have what we're calling directed electives, and those are the mandatory courses that we've put into place that are aligned to college and career. It's Project Lead the Way, they're project-based learning, they're focused on careers, college and career coursework, and so we've included that in their package. Then for their open electives, we've listed the related arts, the fine arts, we've noted that in different buildings, depending on licensure of teachers and just the staffing designs of that particular school, there may be different offerings, but they typically are around these areas of art, music, PE, and such. If you look at the bottom elective, we're looking at a course called academic support, and if you relate it to what's going on at the high school, in the high school we have credit recovery opportunities. This academic support at the middle school would serve in a similar way. If a student at the end of a semester or a grading term is found to be failing a subject, they may lose an open elective and be placed in academic support until they earn that credit back, and then they can go back out into the open electives. So we're trying to make sure that the kids keep their eye on the prize of getting that core content and stay aligned and in preparation for their graduation qualifying exam. When we look at the promotion and progression, as I said, at the end of the first semester, if a student's not progressing, we'll look at the academic support class. What we've set up is at the end of the sixth grade, students should have at least 10 credits out of the 12 to move on to seventh grade, to be classified as a seventh grade. They have to have a total of 20 credits at the end of seventh, and then 32 at the end of ninth grade. Now they have an opportunity for 36 credits. So if you think about what we tried to do was align a general diploma allows a student to get a diploma with 40 credits out of the 56 opportunities, and that's right about 75%. For a core 40, it's at 48 credits, which is right around 86, 87. This would be at 88%. We're asking that they have 88% of their credits. If a student has not completed that, what we can do is we can structure what their ninth grade experience looks like. If their age comes into play, we can look at alternative ed placement. We can look at a retention. We can look at a revised or an adjusted schedule at a high school placement. When we look at our academic support, next year we'll have in each of the middle schools a transition classroom. This transition classroom is designed for students who academically have been struggling and are way off track. We use smaller pupil to teacher ratio, and what we want to do is try to get the kids in that self-contained environment where they can build a relationship with a teacher, and then as they begin to get back on track academically, they start to matriculate back out into the general schedule setup. Those are brand new for next year, so we're excited. We're in the process of staffing those right now. We also have our impact, which is our 30-minute intervention or enrichment for students, and then we have our intercession, and I should have added summer school. Intercession provides 40 hours total in the fall and the spring, and then summer school this year will be right around another 20 hours. Summer school is always dependent upon funding, but so we feel like there are enough systems in place to make sure we have a better understanding of where these kids are and that those kids have an understanding of where they are in the system. So that's no cost. This is a free design, I guess, or an adjustment. But I'm not sure if you have questions of me or the principals.
So how are the students and parents going to be made aware of these changes?
We've had a draft document that we've shared with sixth grade parents, the incoming sixth grade parents, and then upon approval tonight, we have a couple typos we found, and we're making sure that the DOE is a little bit delayed with some of their course changes, name changes they've just come out with. We'll make sure those are aligned, and then we'll put those out at the open houses for parents when they start the year.
Okay. In the past, and I'm speaking of a different time period of my life, but the state used to require middle school students to have a certain number of hours or certain number of times in certain electives. If we remove the students from those electives in order to put them in these other classes, is there going to be an issue there, or is there enough time in their 3 years to get it in?
There's enough time in the 3 years, and the way the language of the statutes read now, it's recommended and exploratory.
It's not, okay.
So it's not defined necessarily that it has
it's not
to
required
be a
anymore.
Certain path. Right.
Okay, good.
Right. And each of the students, even though they may be pulled for one academic support, they would be in another elective. So we wouldn't pull them from both. One of those electives may be the directed elective of the project Lead the Way, but then the following semester, if they're in an academic support, they may be in art, PE, or music at that time.
So basically what we're saying with this plan is that there will be no more failures. You may fail, but you're going to get a chance to pass.
We are
over and over and over.
We are increasing our due diligence to help students.
You know, boy, I just, first of all,
Amy and our middle school principals, they're all here represented, have done great work on this. Mm-hmm. And the reality is this. At the middle school level, we have to make sure that we add a little bit of a motivational factor. A lot of kids at that middle school level, they have the skill set they need to succeed, but maybe they don't work quite as hard as they should. And that needs to be instilled in them. You know, we talk about our Pride program, which is listed right behind me. We need to make sure those skills are ingrained, and we cannot make it easy for these kids to just automatically be moved forward year to year because they're a couple inches taller, a couple pounds heavier. We've got to make sure we set the bar higher. We've got to make sure that while we set the bar higher, that we're providing a higher level of support for them, which we've done. This plan is going to set the bar high but provide a high level of support, and it's needed because we need kids to step up in terms of their performance at the middle school level. And we have the overwhelming majority of kids that do, but we still have that percentage, in my opinion, that's too high, that don't do it. And the sooner we can catch them and set the tone and get them moving in the right direction, the better. And I believe this plan does that work, and I'm commending Amy and all of our middle school people for the work they've done.
Amy, with I saw where physical education is this an elective, and with the push across the state and across the country on wellness policy, on anti-obesity programs and all, was any thought given to making physical education more a part of the curriculum besides an elective?
Right now, it serves as an elective, but we want to make sure. And again, as Ms. Perkins indicated. It's an exploratory for middle school, and so what we'd want to make sure of is, as we look at a middle school student, we want to make sure that they have experiences in all of those. So they wouldn't get through 6th through 8th grade without having a PE class, and they would have to have a PE class at some point through there. So that's what we would make sure.
I think this is excellent. It took me 23 years to get out of middle school, but. but I think it's an excellent plan, because when you put kids in the 9th grade and they've gone from, oh, I failed math, but I'm still moving on to the next grade level, or oh, I failed math and English and I'm still moving on to the next grade level. Once they hit that 9th grade, and it is the hardest thing, as you well know, it's the hardest thing for them to realize, if I don't pass, I don't get that credit and I can't graduate. So I applaud you.
Thank
you're starting this, and I applaud all of our principals that are here, assistant
you.
Principals.
Dr. Harris brought before the Naviance program that we're using for college and career planning as well. That goes down into the middle schools as well. So
super.
We think it'll give kids their kind of comprehensive secondary experience.
Super. Maybe we can get their attention.
Mm-hmm. The transition classroom, that's a new concept, right? I mean, we haven't been doing that in the past.
We've tried it at different points. Some people have called it alternative. Some people, in the past, we've probably used it more as behavioral and or mm-hmm. academic. This is for academic.
Yeah.
And in a lot of ways, what we're trying to do, one of the biggest stoppers of students achieving is that they're not reading at grade level.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you look at the new academic standards that have come through, whether it's science, social studies, they're literacy-based. Then they have standards where kids have to be immersed in text, and it's high-level text. So in order for kids to get that support, we need that model of where they have that teacher who's well-trained and can support them in seeing that transition and that literacy grow.
And that may be will issues as well, right? I mean, it may not just necessarily be, it may additional motivation. Are the parents involved in that? I mean, once they come into the transition classroom, are the parents brought in and say, look,
we have in our impact program, if a student is tier 3, mm-hmm. We have a conference with the parent and we have
okay.
a plan, an academic plan. When we discuss the implementation of this, we consider this tier 3, and that would be part of.
Yeah. I love the concept. I was just
Thank
curious.
You.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Further
okay,
questions?
I just, yeah.
Amy,
go ahead.
A couple more.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Go ahead.
I know everybody's got an out. There's an IRE 3 exemption. There's a graduation waiver. when you say 20 credits or whatever to move on, is that 20 means 20, or do we have a plan in place for a parental waiver, a student waiver to move on to the next grade, or is this the bottom line? You got to have the credits.
When we set up the credit recovery, we at the high school, we use Plato, and basically that program allows for us to say, you've done the seat time for this course, but you did not pass it. As they get into that computer program, they're able to test out. That curriculum's been aligned to our courses, and so they're able to test out of the units. If they have them, if they've mastered the units, then they'll be able to test out and only do the work on what they haven't mastered. We're looking at a similar concept with middle school. They've done the seat time, but now they're not getting it for whatever reason. And if it's an intentional non-learning situation, here's an opportunity for them to prove proficiency, to exhibit their mastery. And that's what our basic concern is. When you say, would parents, what we want to do at the end is we're trying to look at the picture of the whole child. We're trying to look at how they perform on state assessments, how they perform on benchmark assessments, our STAR reading, our STAR math. So we want to look at the portfolio of the student, number one, and make sure that there aren't other issues interfering. If they're on track, then we really want that documentation of mastery. I think with the new GQE, we're getting back into a waiver situation where you're going to have to prove or demonstrate mastery somewhere along the line as part of that waiver. And so I think it's preparing them for that, kind of creating that portfolio of their own demonstration.
The reality, though, Board, is this. If a student has not earned the opportunity to move forward, then we can't let them move forward. We can't give them easy outs. That's just not life. So we have to support them and help them, and we give them every chance in the book, and we're there. We've got dedicated staff that's ready to do whatever necessary. But the one thing we can't do, it'll come a time, because this has happened in other places I've been, where the parent says, wait a minute, you can't do that to my child. The reality is we're not doing it to them, we're doing it for them. They have to be able to make it on their own. We've got to stop enabling these kids. If it means that you're going to stay back a year, you're going to stay in a transition room for a while, you're going to earn the right to get out of there and to move on to the next grade level, then go ahead and go to work. But we have to stop. The overall desire here is that, parent, we love your kid too, but we cannot let them keep moving forward and not being successful. So we're going to do what it takes.
One of the things we found with the intercession is that we typically use their STAR performance to indicate whether they go into. When a student finds out they're going to intercession and it was based on their performance on their last benchmark, they were like, well, I didn't try. So we give them the opportunity to retest, and nine times out of 10, that student exceeds what the limit was. So they're capable of doing it. Some of this, you know, is just needing to see that there's consequence for.
Will there be software in the transition classes? I missed
yes.
that. Yes. Are we using Plato, or are we using something similar? Or?
Right now, that's kind of our district product that we have. There are a couple out there that we'd like to look at, and to be honest, in the next couple of weeks, we'll probably be coming to you. We have several of our schools that are eligible for a SIG grant, a school improvement, where we'd like to look at some other products.
And that was Plato, not Play-Doh,
Plato.
Right?
Yes.
We're not
it's
using
actually
Plato.
Edmentum is the company. Right. Plato is the product.
Okay, I just have one question. What have we done? This probably is not your question. It's probably Dr. Hartlett's question. What have we done to alert the fifth grade that this is coming? Many times in the past, we have not done very well in that respect. And they need to know that and be very clear by fourth, fifth grade that that's coming.
Our current fifth graders have been presented through the open houses that we've had at the middle schools. Mm-hmm. So our current fifth grade, when the document is complete and ready to go for next year, that will be used for next year's fifth graders in preparation in the transition.
So our fifth grade teachers are talking to our sixth grade teachers?
Not as often as we'd like, but more frequently.
Okay, if we suggest strongly that happen, maybe that would happen more. Because that's going to help that child.
Well, the other thing I think is important, and correct me if I'm wrong, but we've sort of been modifying what we're going to do with our sixth grade in terms of how we structure sixth grades at all of our middle schools. so that it'll have a little bit more of an elementary feel to it at the sixth grade level. And so that I think will go a long way to this idea of fifth and sixth grade, vertically being articulated, because I think that we think that transition from fifth to sixth grade is a vital transition. And we think that sometimes if we just throw the kids into the full-fledged middle school, a multi-period schedule with multiple teachers, it might be a little too fast for some. So we're going to offer opportunities to have the a little bit more of an elementary feel at the sixth grade level. And we're pretty excited about that as well.
Okay, thank you.
All right.
Further questions? All right, thank you. Dr. Hartledge is going to take us through iRead.
Okay, good evening. As you know, this year has been somewhat of a banner year for us in the state of Indiana in regard to assessments and standards, and iRead is no exception. This test, the first window was administered in March, and the test has changed this year. I'm going to walk you through a little bit of the history of our Indiana, the reading evaluation and determination system. In 2010, the House Enrolled Act of 1367 was put in place, and it was requiring the evaluation of reading skills because we were simply seeing too many children who were moving on without the necessary foundation to be successful. And so we administered it for the first time in 2012, and this is our fourth time through. And it has been, the rigor level of it has changed in regard to the vocabulary that's been used, the length of the passages, the text complexity, the lexile level in which the students were required to read. And it was really in place to make sure that students could read proficiently. You've heard us talk before in K through 2, we're really teaching children how to read. And then in third grade and on up, we are reading to learn. So it really is one of those checkpoints to make sure children have reached a certain level. What is the difference? You know, now we're just inundated with assessments. So what is the difference between ISTEP and iRead 3? The English language arts portion of ISTEP was developed to measure the student achievement and language arts skills, including writing, and it really helps to calculate our state and federal accountability. While the iRead is specifically for the foundational reading skills through grade 3, and it really is looking back on what the standards are that are required to be mastered in kindergarten, first, and second grade. Here's a little bit more of a comparison. The iRead is a multiple choice version, and it reflects on everything that's been mastered from K to 3, focuses on a portion of the standards. And the ISTEP is applied skills, which is more open-ended items in the testing format, as well as multiple choice, and it's specifically on grade 3 standards. And it is includes all the standards of grade 3. When we talk about foundational reading skills, these are those that begin in kindergarten. It's really the initial stages, including the phonemic awareness, the language acquisition process, phonics, fluency. It's how they really learn to decode those words, become fluent, and then are able to comprehend the words in the text. If they lack these skills, they really have a challenging time in trying to apply those higher level skills as they progress up through the grade levels when they have to read to learn with science and social studies. The iRead includes three main portions: the vocabulary portion, which is specifically vocabulary development. It looks at beginning, middle, end sounds, homonyms, synonyms, suffixes, using context clues to determine the meaning of unknown words. And this year, the test itself was much more advanced vocabulary. And when we look at our diverse environments and the different demographics that we have within our schools, you'll see when you look at the scores that that's indicative in the outcome. But we're very confident that the things that we've had in place are going to help us see more growth in our next round of testing soon to come. The reading portions consist of both nonfiction informational text as well as literary text. In both sections, it's the comprehension and analysis of these different examples. In nonfiction, they look more at making predictions, identifying important information within the text, looking at cause and effect, main idea, and problem and solution. In the literary portion, they're looking more at plot, character traits, development, and identifying the theme, the narrator. They may have to respond to text in some capacity, compare different sections of it. What are the implications if they do not pass? What we do, it's our responsibility to continue to provide a very strong literacy block within our core using effective teaching strategies. It's required of at least 90 minutes a day. Most of our schools have created very creative schedules in which they have more than 90 minutes, including small group instruction, shared reading, guided reading, word work, and more frequent progress monitoring of how they're progressing through this instruction, as well as daily targeted interventions that are focused specifically on skill deficits within their reading. They've worked very hard to diagnose what are the obstacles that are preventing them from being successful. And then they will have an opportunity to retake the test in June after our summer school week. They'll come to school June 15th through the 19th, and then they will take the test the second time, June 19th. We talked a little bit briefly about the different waivers and exemptions that can come in play, and students are eligible for good cause exemptions if they have previously been retained 2 years. If they are a student with disabilities through the case conference committee, that can be determined that promotion is appropriate. Maybe there's certain reasons that they feel like that are preventing the child from being successful. And sometimes in these cases, retention is more detrimental than it is advantageous for them. And then, of course, our English language learners, whose ILPs would determine that that is not the appropriate result for them. And we'll go ahead and promote them. And here's our data. When you look across the board, we did have 5 schools that increased their scores. So in light of the changes that are made to the test, we're very proud of those results. But in just a moment, we can look at our overall score has decreased from last year. But we are very confident once we go through this second round that our scores will be back up. And when we look at our district data compared to the state data, last year, the state has also dropped the same exact amount as we have this first test, or this first testing go round. But we still, we feel like we're on track. Most of the principals have gone through this. They have targeted the students that they were concerned that may not pass. And they've really been providing remediation and necessary support for them. So when they come back around the second time, they're hopeful that they'll do a better job. We did make consistent gains over the past 2 years, again, with the recent test changes. This has put us in the same, when you look at the spring first administration of the state, compared to our district in 2014, we were ahead of the state 1.1%. When you compare that to the 2015 spring, the state and the district overall, we've dropped the exact same amount from the previous year. But we are still ahead of the state average. The state results include public and non-publics, but when you look at just the public schools only, we're actually 2.6% above of the state scores. So we are confident with what we've done and the work that's been done that we'll come back and see continued growth. Here's a comparison of our neighboring districts on the test this year, and as you can see, we're ahead of West Clark and Clarksville, where we have in the past lost some of our students, and our scores are above that, and the New Albany, we're right there neck and neck. But we will continue to work very hard to deliver those interventions, and we'll administer the second round on June 19th.
Questions for Dr. Hartledge?
So we have a chance to make up that 3% after the June 19th test.
Correct.
We could be ahead of last year's results.
And historically, we always do come back much better. And this is that first time where we've had conversations with families, we've talked to parents, they understand the importance. It really helps to get additional support at home with what we're doing at school. Our children work very, very hard in these last few weeks. They understand the implications of not passing and what those ramifications could be. So I am hopeful that we'll see an increase when we test again.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Hartledge. All right, next we're to the consent agenda. Tonight we have seven items. We're going to pull item number six, which is personnel other two. So I'd like to take items 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 7 together.
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. Second. And thank you, Ms. Zolman. Any questions, comments on those six items? All right, all in favor? Be 6-0. Thank you. Next we're going to look at personnel other item number six, and I think Dr. Mellon wanted to talk with us a little bit before.
Board, if you don't mind, this item is a request for a job description for an assistant superintendent for secondary. We are in a situation in our district where it's critical that we look at alignment of all of our people across our central office, and we have done that study for about 3 years now. This assistant superintendent for secondary education is a position that would be in charge of all of our middle schools and high schools and be the point person for a college and career readiness initiative. Just like Dr. Hartledge is in charge of all of our elementary operation, this person would have the same kind of role at the secondary level. And with everything that's going on in terms of expectations that I know you have for me moving forward, if there is a potential to move forward on a referendum, the amount of time and effort that's going to take to be out in the community and be visible and be answering questions is going to be pretty enormous. So we have, for the past year, Ms. Lewis is at a part-time status for us. And so people would ask, well, wait a minute, what about the timing of all of this? Well, the fact is that from a financial perspective, we're not going to be really adding any kind of FTE to the circumstance. Ms. Lewis is actually 0.5 FTE on an administrative basis now as a part-time executive in our central office. And we have another administrative position that's being eliminated in our district after this year. And so we're not adding in terms of our administrative staff, but we are realigning the responsibilities. And I do need to bring someone in who will have that level of expertise to take care of that level of responsibility. So we're not adding to the FTE, and we're also financially not adding to our obligation on our general fund. And ever since I've been your superintendent, I've worked really hard to take a look at when we've made modifications administratively, what are the financial impacts of that? And this is another one of those cases where I've gone without this year. I've worked with Ms. Lewis has done a really good job on a part-time basis, but we've not filled her part, you know, the other half of her position all year long. And so that has lent itself to the fact that we now need to take a look at the organization and what do we need to move forward. So I'm asking tonight for permission for you to approve the job description, and then I will post the position if you approve the job description, and then we'll move forward and see if there's a candidate out there that would be the right fit for our school corporation.
questions? All right, Ms. Kraft, thank you.
Second.
Thank you. Ms. Perkins, any questions, comments for Dr. Mellon? All right, all in favor? B6-0, thank you. Ms. Kraft, would you be so kind as to take us through the gifts to buildings tonight?
Gracious, it's a huge list. Let's just say thank you very much to the community. It looks like New Washington really came out good this time. And we have almost $12,000 that was donated to the school corporation. We just always are very, very appreciative of what the community, they have a lot of faith in us, and we appreciate that. And we just need a motion to accept it.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Kraft.
I'll second
and
that.
Thank you, Ms. Zellman. All right, all in favor? B6-0, thank you. Moving into action items, first item is the bid award for bus purchases, Midwest Transit.
Yes.
Dr. Dykel.
Notice to bidders was published on Friday, August 3rd, and Friday, April 3rd, I'm sorry, and Friday, April 10th, for one or more 2013-16 model year 72 or 78 passenger school buses and one or more 2013-16 model year mini 18 passenger and two wheelchair. Proposals were due by 2 p.m. on April 23rd. We had responses from three vendors, which was great. Normally it's only one. What we'd like to do is to say that Midwest Transit should be the one getting all nine buses. We're looking at 2016 International 78 passenger in stock new, four of those for $79,065 each for a total of $316,260. One minibus, 2016 International 18 seat with two wheelchairs, built to spec $91,200, four of those, and will be happy, $364,800. And those also will have air conditioning too. And then 2015 International bus 72 passenger with air brakes, one of those for $74,272. So this whole purchase is $755,332. That's what we're asking permission for.
All right, thank you, Dr. Dykel. Questions, comments for Dr. Dyke?
On the mid buses, are those four gonna be at the service center or at a school?
They'll be at the service center.
Have we ever, and I never have really understood, why don't our middle schools get a mid-bus instead of having to go borrow one from the high school and go track one down? Why it seemed like at some point it's like, okay, let's get our middle schools a mid-bus to take care of some of these transportation issues.
I don't know, Mr. Hall, if it was because we just didn't have the money to buy them or if there just wasn't enough activity to warrant one to have it sitting there at a middle school. I'd have to check and see.
I think one of the things that I would just, I know our mid-buses, we have some work to do. You know, we're finally having some money to buy new buses. For the first time since I've been here, we finally have some money to try to do this. We do need to come up with a plan because even the mini buses that we have at our schools are at a point in time where they need to be repaired, but I don't think there's ever been a plan for how to do that. Mm-hmm. And I think that's one of the things that we've talked about is how do we build that plan so that we can start replacing out these vehicles. And so one of the parts of that plan could be how do we add that level of bus at our middle schools for activities. It's definitely something we can put a plan together.
Are these buses replacing old or are they additional new?
No, these are going to be replacing some of the old ones. We just don't have a dollar figure yet for Midwest Transit for trade-in. I want to see what their trade-in will be. When we auctioned them last time, a year ago, we only got $3,500 per bus, which wasn't much. I think we can get anywhere between $5,000 and $7,000 per bus on a trade-in, so I want to see what that trade-in costs will be. We may come back to you at the next future board meeting to say now we are trading in X number of buses to Midwest Transit and we'll end up getting X amount per bus. So it just depends. Or we may end up going to auction. I may come back to you at a future date and say we may auction them again. I don't know. I just want to see what I'm going to get from Midwest Transit.
Okay. You know what I'm going to say.
Pardon me?
You know what I'm going to say before I say it, right?
I know.
just for the record, I do not think we should be having 78 passenger buses unless you're going to have a monitor on there all the time. And you're already having problems, or we are, finding drivers. I would love to meet the people who want to raise their hand and haul around 76 kids, one driver and 76 kids in back of them. I would like to meet that person. Can you arrange that?
I will try.
Uh-huh.
I know we go around and around.
It's too many kids.
Are we still having trouble finding bus drivers?
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was.
For 66 passenger buses.
Yeah.
Trying to find bus drivers,
and
aides.
I worry about 78 passengers and 78 passenger buses in subdivisions. That's going to be a real turnabout.
Yeah, we're going to be very careful as far as where they put the 78 passengers. I mean, it's not going to be in downtown Jeff, that's for sure. I don't think so, but I mean, Ken was talking about more in the Charlestown area where it's more open is what we're looking at, especially where you have a lot of kids where maybe we ended up having a straggler bus go behind another bus for another 5 or 7 kids, that going to a little bit bigger bus, we can eliminate the straggler bus.
So a brand new bus is going to have last how many years? What do you anticipate for a brand new bus?
For us?
Uh-huh.
State law says 12. We go past 12. We go probably 15, 16 years on a bus. And it depends. I mean, some buses are real good, and we want to keep them longer because the engine's good, the body's good. Other buses, they may not be good, and we want to trade them in after 12 because of mechanical problems that we just can't continue to keep repairing. So it just depends. I mean, I've had it where they've traded in newer buses and kept the older buses because they were much better shape running wise. It just depends on the bus, the model, the make, the year. You know, you have good ones, you have bad ones. So.
All right, further questions for Dr. Dykel? We need a motion.
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Hall.
Second.
I was expecting Nancy to give me the motion.
Thank you, Ms. Perkins. All right, further questions? All right, all in favor? B5, and opposed, 1. Okay, thank you.
I will express your concerns.
I'm just sure you will.
All right.
I've just been there and done that. It's just not good.
All right, next item is a bid award for contract bus route. Dr. Dykel?
Yes, the notice of intent to negotiate for school bus transportation fleet contract routes was published on Saturday, April 11th, 2015, and April 18th. For 15 bus routes, we had one that we had to renegotiate. Proposals were open and negotiated on April 30th. The administration would like to award the bus contract route 5W to Sherry Woods, which is Route 84 at the daily rate of $270.
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Hall.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Kraft. Questions, comments? All in favor? B6-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next is the bid award for the JHS Radio TV construction project and approval to bid the CHS Radio TV and New Washington High School radio construction projects. That's a mouthful there.
It's a mouthful.
Dr. Hare?
Thanks, Mr. Pavey and Board. Board, the bid was received for Jeffersonville High School's radio TV construction project on Friday, May the 15th. Mr. Covert with Hal Covert with Covert Hawkins has submitted the bid tabulation showing the base bid and the alternates. He's also submitted a letter recommending the rejection of this bid based on the rationale that the bid was non-responsive to the specifications. He further would recommend that we re-advertise and rebid the project. Copies of those bid tabulations and the letter of the recommendation are attached. And with your approval, in talking with Mr. Covert, we could publish this on May the 21st and the 28th. We would receive bids on June the 8th at 2 o'clock. We would need a special board meeting somewhere around June 9th or 10th in order to keep these construction projects on track. In addition, we're ready to go ahead and bid the Charlestown High School radio TV and the New Washington radio and TV station. So at this time, Mr. Pavey and Board, the superintendent would recommend that the recommendation of Hal Covert Architect is to reject the bid received, to re-advertise and rebid the construction project for the Jeffersonville High School radio TV studio, and further recommend the approval to bid Charlestown High School radio TV studio, as well as the new Washington High School radio TV studio.
Very good. Thank you.
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Hall.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Perkins. Any questions, comments for Dr. Hare? All in favor? B6-0. Thank you. Next is the Athletic Training Services Agreement for Charlestown, Jeffersonville, and New Washington High Schools. Dr.
Yes,
Hare?
Sir. Board and Mr. Pavey, thank you. This is pretty straightforward. We've done this for the last several years, and just to kind of, as a friendly reminder, the corporation pays a portion of the athletic training services based on the ECA. There used to be positions where we would hire an athletic trainer and pay them what we paid a coach. And whatever that stipend is that we paid a coach, that's the portion that the corporation pays to have the athletic trainers at all three of our high schools. And then any difference is made up with by the athletic department. The agreements have really worked well at all three high schools. STAR has changed their name, and you approved that some time ago, to Floyd Memorial Hospital and Health Services. Theirs is pretty much standard. They changed a little bit. Their item 12, if you saw that, they were going to do some, it was in regards to advertising and hanging a banner. The court is who provides the athletic training services at Jeffersonville High School. They showed a 3% increase. And then at New Washington, it stayed the same. Mr. Randy Burton provides our athletic training services up there. The only other addition is due to the 2.5 increase that all employees received, 2.5% of that ECA position, or that stipend that someone ever got, that raised our portion, that 2.5%. So we will be paying, the corporation will be paying a little bit more than what we've paid in the past due to that raise, just like the football coach got a raise, the basketball coach, the tennis coach, et cetera. So that's the only difference. So other than that, board, it really, for as far as the services and everything, straightforward, the same services we've been receiving. The athletic directors and principals at all three high schools, very pleased with what we're receiving.
Okay, thank you. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Perkins. Thank you, Mr. White. And I see Ms. Lewis has reviewed the contracts.
Yes, sir. I apologize. I should have said that. Thank you.
All right. Questions, comments? All in favor? B6-0. Thank you.
Thank you.
Textbook adoption, elementary math and secondary social studies. And Ms. Schellenberg has this.
Thank you. The Department of Ed has changed their adoption cycle. And the last time that we adopted math, the elementary at the time decided to stay with a continued adoption. As they've gotten through the last 5 years, the materials and resources are really in poor shape, so they were ready to adopt. We went ahead and piloted several publishers this year, and I appreciate the help of Karen Spencer. She managed all that process, and the teachers came together and have selected the McGraw-Hill for their selection. The secondary textbooks, and for some reason the middle school was cut off. Middle school is McGraw-Hill for social studies. These were done collaboratively with all of the middle schools, representatives from all of the middle schools. Again, following what we adopted last year for language arts, the text for the students are digital, the electronic, and as a result, they all get about a classroom set of hardback books for each of the teachers. It's kind of reversed now, free with purchase as you go back. So now every student has digital access for their Chromebooks.
Okay. Very good. Thank you.
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Hall. You have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Perkins. Questions? All right. All in favor? B6-0. Thank you. Next is the middle school course guidance.
This is the document that we put together as I presented. It basically outlines everything that we talked about in the earlier presentation, and also includes the state course descriptions for each of the courses that we're offering. We wanted to include that because of the switch in standards to the college and career readiness, to make sure everyone was aware of the standard for academic standards for those particular courses.
Okay, thank you.
There are a couple typos. Number one, on the table of contents, it should say middle school guiding principles, not grading principles. That was one we caught, so we will make that change.
All right. All right, do we have a motion?
Motion to approve.
Thank you, Mr. White.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Zolman. Questions or comments from Ms. Schellenberg? All in favor? 6-0, thank you. And last item is the Common School Loan Acceptance.
Right, last month, Dr. Dykel and I brought the application to you. We were awarded, and again, as Dr. Dykel's talked about, the impact of tax caps, especially on capital projects, this Common School Loan, low interest, has really been able to help us offset and stay on track with technology purchases.
Okay, thank you. We have a motion.
So moved.
Thank you, Mr. Hall.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Kraft. Any questions, comments? All in favor? 6-0. Thank you. All right. Next item is discussion items. I don't think we have any tonight, so we'll move on to reports and requests. Any reports or requests from any of the board members?
I have none.
All right. Ms. Perkins?
No, thank you.
Zolman?
No, thank you.
Ms. Kraft?
Thank you.
Mr. Hall?
No, thank you.
Okay. Dr. Mellon, next is public comments on non-agenda items. I don't believe we have none tonight. Okay, thank you. Okay, come into board comments. So, Mr. White?
Well, you all heard the presentation on the facilities, and I would encourage you to, if you're not already behind it, to at least study it, to keep an open mind, say that I have a commercial building and four rental houses, so I know it's going to impact me, but I know the value of what I'm doing, too. So, keep an open mind. Remember where your priorities are, the children, your children, my grandchildren. That's everything. So I want to thank you all for coming tonight.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. White. Ms. Perkins?
I can guarantee our publics that this board has looked long and hard at all the data that's been provided to us, and we've had many conversations about the positives and the negatives, and I appreciate what you just said, Jerry, and I think you kind of summed it up very well.
All right, thank you. Ms. Owen?
I just want to thank you for coming tonight, and also, again, I'm going to say I'm really excited about the facility. If I have to pay taxes, I can't think of anything better to pay taxes for than our kids. So I am 100% plus in favor of the facility plan. So I hope we can encourage lots of people to get on board.
All right, thank you, Ms. Ullman. Ms. Kraft?
I just feel like if we can keep our special need kids in a building where they belong and not have to transport them someplace else, and if we can get preschool in every building, I'll be really happy. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Mr. Hall?
No, thank you.
All right, I don't have anything. Dr. Mellon?
Board, just thanks to our team over here. A lot of good presentations tonight. We're doing a lot of good work. We don't want to lose our focus. The facilities are important, but our focus is on our students, and we're doing a lot of great things for them. So I have a great team over here and in the seats here as well. So proud to have them here and appreciate all their help and support.
All right. Thank you, Dr. Mellon. Adjournment. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Ms. Perkins. And a second?
Second for him.
Thank you, Ms. Kraft. All in favor? All right. Good night.